Yeah, I'm down near Daytona Beach, New Smyrna Beach area, it's on the east coast, and been there 19 years. We did live in Walpole, Massachusetts for 40-something years. Thank God for deliverance. But anyway, we've been down there 19 years, and you know, God told us to go to Florida. He said He would expand our ministry greater in Florida than it was in the New England area. And I look back and I see how God has done that, and I think it's because we traveled in a music ministry for like 11 years, my wife and our four children, and we were known as the Mike Peterson Family Singers, and we traveled up in Maine a lot and stuff, and all the New England states, so it was fun, and I was a plumber in Massachusetts, so I was a plumber for 18 years, thank God for deliverance there too. But God called me out of the plumbing trade into the ministry, and God told me, he says, you start praying for the sick, he says, you build their faith, and I'll show up and heal them. So I thought that was a pretty good deal. Amen? So I've seen blind eyes open, deaf ears unstopped, all types of things. I've seen people get out of wheelchairs and walk, all in the mighty name of Jesus. So He's the healer here today. Amen?
Yes.
And if you're going to receive anything, you're going to have to touch the hem of His garment.
Yes.
But He's here, and we're here. So I hope you came expecting today, because I have a word for the body today that I believe is going to enlighten you, and we're going to see God do some great things this week. Amen?
Yes.
So before I do that, I'd like to sing this one song. Let's worship the Lord together. Amen? Praise God. Touch through me, Holy Spirit. Touch through me. Let my hands reach out to others. Touch through me. There's a lonely soul somewhere needing just one friend to care. Touch through me, Holy Spirit. Touch through me. Love through me, Holy Spirit. Love through me. I will be my brother's keeper. Are bleeding deep inside. Love can dry the weeping eyes. Love through me, Holy Spirit. Love through me. Through me, oh. Praise God. I pray that's your desire today. Amen. God, use you to touch someone else. Well, I'm excited to be here this week, and I've seen God just do some tremendous things this year. I've seen many people get saved. I've seen just incredible healings of God's power. I'm glad for God's faithfulness. You know, God says in His Word that He will do something, He will do it. Amen? And so this morning I want to minister out of the book of John chapter 10 today. John chapter 10. And I think I'll start in verse 22. It says, they came. Then came the feast of the dedication at Jerusalem, and it was winter, and Jesus was in the temple area walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews gathered around him, saying, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. And Jesus answered, I did tell you, but you did not believe. The miracles I do in my Father's name speak for me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. And no one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. And no one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. Father, we just thank you for your word to us today. We'd ask you to build our faith and teach us this morning what you want us to learn. We'll be sure to give you all the praise and the glory for everything that takes place today. We ask it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. My sheep will hear my voice. My sheep will hear my voice. How many want to hear the voice of God? You know, I hear Christians over the years, and I've been saved almost 40 years now, hard to believe, but nevertheless, I've always heard Christians say, I wish God would talk to me. I wish I could know how to be led by God or by His Spirit. Well, it's pretty simple if we study the Word of God. Because I'm convinced that we are too easily distracted in the rush of our modern world that we live in today. There are so many choices and so many distractions, all demanding our time and our attention, as you well know. And sadly, though, it seems that we hear only what we want to hear. And we often tune out Jesus because we're so busy with the daily life that we live in. We do not take the time to hear His voice, and we wonder why we don't hear His voice. It's because we don't take that time. We don't spend time in His Word. We don't spend time praying or talking to Him. And then we don't spend time even waiting to listen to Him. You know, maybe part of the problem is that we do not really have the trust and relationship that we think we have with Him. And so we don't spend that time. How much one-on-one time do you set aside for Him? We all need to ask that question. How often do you spend time with the one you call Lord? Interesting, because a lot of people call Lord, but they never spend time with Him. And, you know, maybe this little story that I wrote down about hearing from God might help us a little bit, because these two men were walking along in a crowded city sidewalk, and suddenly one of the men remarked, listen to how lovely the sound of that cricket is. But the other man could not hear the sound of the cricket, and he said to his friend, how can you hear the sound of the cricket with all the roaring traffic and, you know, all the sounds of the people? And the first man, who was a zoologist, had trained himself to hear the sounds of nature. But he did not explain to his friend in words how he could hear the sound of the cricket. But instead, he reached into his pocket, he took out a silver dollar, and he dropped it on the sidewalk in the midst of all these people and the traffic going by. And all of a sudden, there was about a dozen people in that area stopped because they heard the clinking sound of the silver hitting the sidewalk, and they're all looking around for the coin. And then he said, we hear what we want to listen for.
Right.
we hear what we want to listen for. Maybe this is our problem with the voice of Jesus. We hear everything else but Him. And I think because we are not willing to listen, and maybe we're not even wanting to hear His voice sometimes, because maybe we're afraid that He might say something we won't want to hear. You know, I think of sometimes like that old Verizon commercial, when Christians come to hearing God, they go, "Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? No, your batteries are dead." And I think a lot of times, because we don't spend time with God and in His Word, we are becoming dull of hearing Him in the spirit realm. And this scripture is a promise. This scripture is true. You know, my sheep will hear my voice. I mean, that's an absolute statement from Jesus Himself. It doesn't say we could hear His voice, or should hear His voice, or might hear His voice. The scripture clearly tells us, my sheep will, present and future, hear my voice. And I know this may sound a little strong here this morning in saying this, but I think it needs to be said in the churches of America, not just here. But if you're not hearing the voice of the Lord, then you're probably not walking in His will. I mean, how can I know God's will, we ask? Well, what is His will for me? We ask these questions constantly. And a lot of times we want to know exactly what that means and how we can know the will of God. And what we're really saying is we want to discern, we want to understand His plan for our lives. Well, the best way to do that, of course, is study His Word. Because God's Word is a love letter to mankind. And He explains all about Himself, what we need to know, and what we're responsible to do as children of God. I remember one time when I was jogging through the town forest in Massachusetts here several years back, and I remember it was a beautiful day. I just started in ministry. God had just, you know, taken me out of the plumbing trade. And I remember I was jogging in the woods, and it was a beautiful, I think it was like a Monday. And I said, "Lord, can you make another beautiful day like this tomorrow? I'm supposed to play golf with two of the pastors of my church." Loud and clear, the Lord says, "I want you to pray all day tomorrow." I was like, "Ooh." I stopped and I went, "God, was that you or was that me?" And He said to me, "Do you want to play golf tomorrow?" And I went, "Yeah." He said, "Then it wasn't you." Well, and that's how God can talk to us, if we're willing to listen. And I was spending a lot of time in prayer, so He said, "I want you to pray all day tomorrow." I said, "Well, how am I going to get out of that golf game? You know, I can't tell these guys I've got to pray all day tomorrow." I'm thinking, "Oh, Mr. Spiritual, you know." But the Lord said, "I already took care of that." So I jogged home, and I got home. My wife said, "Oh, the pastor called, said they can't play golf tomorrow. Postponed until next week. Other things came up." And I went, "Oh, okay." So I had to pray. You know, God wanted to pray all day. So I figured I'd pray 8 to 4. And 8 hours, I figured that was a day. And I remember about 8:05, I'm drinking my last cup of coffee. I'm going, "God, is this going to be boring?" And He goes, "Just get in there." So I got into prayer, and I prayed for 8 hours, and God spoke to me and taught me some things and showed me some things. And then He had me do that for the next 2 weeks every day, for 2 weeks every day, all day long. As a matter of fact, my youngest son at the time was 15, and he said, "What do I tell people your job is now? Pray." Yup. I said, "I'm hearing from God. Tell everybody I'm hearing from God. That's what's important." Why? Because my sheep will hear my voice. Amen? Amen. You know, we want His guidance in specific decisions so we can make wise choices. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, we all ask that. But I ask those same questions. I said, "Lord, how am I going to get out of the plumbing trade and into the ministry that You've called me to do? I mean, You called me loud and clear. How do I do it?" And He said, "Well, what I'm going to do," and He spoke to me. I was jogging in the forest, and I sat down by the river and said, "How am I going to get out of the plumbing trade and into the ministry? I'm the one that's working. My wife doesn't have a job. We got 3 kids, 4 kids. And the Lord spoke to me loud and clear as I listened. He said, I'm going to start a daycare in your house. I'm going to bring in children. Your wife's going to start a daycare, and she's going to have, when the daycare, I'm going to raise it up to surpasses your income. And then I'm going to take you out of the plumbing trade and put you in the ministry. And then I'm going to build up the ministry, and then I'm going to decrease the daycare, and you'll be full-time working for me in ministry. Oh, what? Sorry I asked. So I went jogging home to tell my wife the good news that she was going to have a daycare. Yeah, just what she needs. 20 more kids, right? We already had 4. But nevertheless, I jogged home, and I jogged home and I went in the house and I said, hey, Barbara, I need to talk to you about what God just spoke to me about. And she said, well, before you say anything, you know my girlfriend there that's got a daycare? She said, yeah. I said, yeah. She's got 10 kids. And a woman came to her today and she's got 2 kids she wants her to watch, you know, $200 a week, but she can't. She's only allowed for 10 because of the law. And she called me and asked me if I'd be interested. What do you think? I guess it'll be all right. So I said, this is what the Lord told me. So, and that's exactly what happened. And when God, she had like 20 kids in a year, and she made way beyond what I was making as a plumber. And then God got me laid off. Company went bankrupt. I couldn't get a job, and I was trying. And I just didn't want to give in to that, you know. Well, I'm full-time. Well, I'm in full-time ministry. Wait a minute. Well, I don't know how to preach a sermon. I have nowhere to go. How can you be in full-time ministry? But God wanted me to pray. And that's how it started. So, anyway. So, I asked God, and God told me. That's what I'm trying to say here today. You know, it's interesting. We want His guidance in specific decisions. So we can make those wise choices. You know, there's a great old evangelist years ago. His name was Leonard Ravenhill. And he made this statement one time. He says, men give advice, God gives guidance. And that's what we need. You know, we need God's guidance, not men's advice. Yes, we listen to godly men and we take heed of what they say, and iron sharpens iron. But we definitely need God's voice. We need to hear Him. Knowing the voice of God results in finding the will of God for your life. God wants you to know His will. His word is His will. And so that's why it's important, because the scripture tells us in Matthew 4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word, I want you to catch this, by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Did you catch that? Where's the word come from? Out of the mouth of God. See, the word proceeds. It speaks of a continuing function. It means something that happened in the past is happening in the present and will continue to happen in the future. This is why it's important to know the voice of God. Very important. I mean, there are 2 Greek words, and I heard our sister there, Mary, quote a couple of Greek things this morning. So I guess you're familiar, a little bit. I'm not a Greek scholar by any means, but I understand a few things when I read and study, and there's a couple of Greek words translated for the word, W-O-R-D, which is logos and rhema. Y'all heard of that, right? Logos, rhema. Logos means the written word of God. Logos is often described as the general word of God. When you read the word of God, you're reading what is called in the Greek, logos. Right? Okay. So, through the scripture, you can receive all the knowledge you need concerning God's will and His promises, but just through reading, you do not receive that rhema, the word. For the voice of God. We'll receive knowledge, we'll receive understanding by studying the Word of God. because it tells us right over there in about God in Joshua 1:8, and it says this. It says, "Do not let the book of the law," God says to Joshua, "depart from your mouth, but meditate on it day and night, that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful." So reading the Word, studying the Word will make you prosperous and successful. You will be able to deal with the affairs of life. That's what he just said. Paul shares this truth in Romans. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Romans 10:17. Now, in this scripture, the Word of God is not, the Word of God is not Logos, but Rhema. He's saying, faith comes by hearing, and hearing from the Rhema, voice of God. I want you to catch this, because to me, this is the key on hearing from God. Logos has been defined as the written word, or the said word of God, and Rhema as the saying, or the action word of God. Hearing his voice. It's God giving a specific word to you, or a rhema as an action word. This is what happens here. You know, it's like when you read the Word of God, all of a sudden, you've read that passage 100 times, and all of a sudden, God speaks to you out of that. That's the rhema. I remember Peter and the disciples were out in the boat, and the storm, and Jesus comes walking by in the middle of the night, and they were terrified. It's a ghost. They cried out. Jesus said, "Don't fear, it's I, the Lord." And Peter said, "If that is you, give me a word. Give me a rhema." Well, when he said, "Come," Peter didn't hesitate. He didn't think twice. Why? He got a spoken word from God that caused him to step out in faith. What causes us to step out in faith and do things for the Lord? We hear the rhema, or the voice of God. God didn't tell you to go tell somebody about him. That's the rhema. See, we just read the Word of God. Peter knew Jesus. He walked with him, you know, ministered with him, watched him. But he didn't get out of that boat, nor did the other disciples, until they got a word, or a rhema, from the Lord. See, faith comes by rhema, or hearing the voice of God. The sheep hear his voice, is what we just read. Hearing the voice of God is what compels us to do something by faith. Pastor is in ministry because he heard the voice of God. Preach the word! Amen. I'm in ministry because God says to me, and I'm out jogging, And God says, "I want you to start preaching faith. I want you to lay hands on the sick, and I'll show up and heal them." Well, I got a rhema. So you know what I did? I started preaching faith, and I started praying for people. Did they get healed? No. But that didn't matter. I heard God tell me to do it. So it kept me compelled to keep praying for the sick. And then they started getting healed. 1 out of 10. 2 out of 10. Now I've seen 10 out of 10. Why? Because God said do it, and he'll show up and heal the people. That's why I never panic praying for people that are blind or deaf or in wheelchairs. I don't panic. Oh, what if they don't get healed? That's not my concern. It's God's concern. I'm doing what the Word of God told me to do. God spoke to me and said, "Pray for the sick." I got a rhema. That means I'm going to do it. Well, what if they don't get healed? What's that got to do with me? I'm not the healer. I'm the prayer. God's the answerer. And I heard his voice say, "Do it," and that compelled me to do it. Did I do it before? No. Well, maybe once in a while when someone said, "Hey, do you think we ought to pray for so-and-so?" Well, okay. Never see it work too often, but okay. I used to ask the Lord, "How come I never seen this healing work when I was a deacon?" And we prayed for the sick at the altar. He said, "How often did you pray for the sick before you came to that Sunday service?" How about zero? He goes, yeah, you just expected the oil to do something, right? Well, yeah. But, you know, it's got to be bathed in prayer. You've got to go after God. You've got to get the anointing from God. God has already called you to do a specific thing, and it's going to happen. That's all there is to it. That's why I pray for people. I can't heal them, but it's going to happen. I mean, people here this week, this morning, you're going to get healed, whatever you come to God for. How can I say that? I got a rhema. God spoke to me. Pray for the sick. I'll show up and heal them. Okay. Oh, I'm trying to convince you this morning and this week that God's a healer. If you believe His word, you're going to get it. Amen?
Amen?
See, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the rhema of God. You know, when I remember when God spoke to us about moving to Florida. You know, we lived in Massachusetts 46 years I was there. And I remember the Lord, 47 years. He told us to move to Florida. Now, He had told me long before this to go, you know, I want you to go to Florida. We used to vacation down there. And people that left our church went down there, bought these little cabins on the beach, and we'd stay there every year for a week. And I kept saying to my wife, you know, isn't this nice down here? Would you like to live down here? She goes, no. Oh, no, this is going to be good. God tells me to move to Florida. So I remember I was traveling all over the country at the time, and I asked a couple of pastors' wives, I don't get my wife to go to Florida. God wants us to move there. Should I just make her go? You can't do that, I was told, right? She's got to hear from God. Because if you pull her out away from her, you know, grandchildren, her children, her mother, and the family, and all that, she's going to be angry at you the rest of your life. I didn't want that. So I just waited. I just kept praying. And I was out in Arizona, and I was doing some meetings, and I remember I was staying at my aunt's house when I was finished up some of the meetings. I stayed an extra day or two visiting, and I remember I called my wife the night before I'm flying out back to Massachusetts and from Arizona. And so I talked to her the night before, so I'm ready in the morning to go. My aunt called me on the phone. She goes, hey, I can put a free call for you to home. And I said, well, I just talked to my wife last night. You know, back then, you got charged for long-distance calls and stuff, you know. Well, you still do, but it's package stuff today. But anyway, so I said, the Lord said, call home. Wow, that kind of got me startled, you know, when I heard the voice of the Lord say, call home. I went, okay, put the call through. And so she put the call through, and my wife picked up the phone. I said, hi, what's going on? She goes, we got to move! What? We got to move. And I went, where? She goes, Florida. And I went, I just talked to you last night. What happened? Oh, the Lord kept me up all night, told me we got to move to Florida. Well, I was kind of dumbfounded. You know, I'm thinking, holy moly, these things can happen so quick sometimes with the Lord. I've been praying for 5 years, and now all of a sudden it's happened. It's like, well, wait a minute, I'll be home in about 5 hours. Let's talk about this. The Lord said, don't stop what I'm trying to do. I've been working on her a long time. And my wife said, should I go tell my mother and the kids and all that? And I thought, well, if she does tell her mother and the kids, then I know she's heard from God. But she would never do that. So I got home, everybody knew about it. We're moving to Florida. Wow. So we moved inside of 3 months. Sold everything in our house. My wife put just tags of prices on everything in the house. People walked through our house and bought stuff, you know. I come home one day and I said, hey, where's my chair for my desk there? She goes, oh, I got $50 for it. I said, I paid $150 for that. Well, you can't take it with us. She was zealous to move. I wasn't. But see, she heard from God. I heard from God. And so it made it easy to go. It was like I was in a lull anyway. It was like I was in a cloud moving, you know, selling everything and then going. It was weird. But that's God, you know. It's like, I remember one time the Lord kept my wife up all night, and she said to me, yeah, I'm really tired. The Lord kept me up all night. And I said, oh. She goes, I said, why don't you wake him up? I said, oh, really? What did the Lord say? It's you I need to deal with, not him. He'll do whatever I tell him. But you know, it's exciting, you know, when you, you know, I mean, these are one-on-one conversations with God. I mean, isn't that exciting?
Yes.
And we can all have that. God told me the more I spend in His time and in His presence, He said, I could talk to Him like I'm talking to my wife on the telephone. And I have. Just many times. You know? I mean, I know God speaks other ways to us, you know, some people get called to be saved, and they go, well, I didn't hear the voice of God, but I felt guilty about my sin. Well, you did hear the voice of God.
That's right.
Spirit says nobody comes to God unless they're drawn by the Spirit of the Lord, right? Amen. So, yeah, we do hear, but sometimes we don't recognize it, and this is the point. We need to get to a place where we hear God. After all, we are the sheep. Amen? You know, without the rhema, it's impossible, or the voice of God, it's impossible to please God, because Peter never walked on water because of a logos, because of general knowledge of him, but he walked on water because he got a specific word from the Lord. Come. He heard the voice of the Lord. You know, Peter asked, Lord, if that's you, command me to come. Jesus replied, come. So the word that Christ gave Peter was a rhema. It was a spoken word which caused him to be compelled with faith to just jump out of the boat. He didn't ask for a life preserver. He didn't say, tie a rope around me. No, he didn't worry about that. Why? Because when God says something, you just do it.
That's
what compels us. Faith comes by hearing the word or the voice or the rhema of God. The word of Christ brought forth faith in Peter. Peter walked on water because he received that word. And we can walk on water when we receive that word. When God tells us to do something, we know we've heard, you're compelled. You just have to do it. I mean, listen, through the scriptures you can begin to know God. And you can gain that understanding and that knowledge about Him. Paul shares this with Timothy in the scripture that's given in 2 Timothy 3:16, he said, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. It is profitable for doctrine and for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness. That's what the word of God is for. The scriptures are extremely important in our lives, and we are called to read and inwardly digest the scriptures on a regular basis. That's why Logos is like the man, you know, in the healing service, and he's sitting there, and he's got eyeglasses on, and he's getting hearing the word preached on healing, and all of a sudden he hears a word from God says, "By my stripes you were healed. It's yours." He got a rhema. So what does he do? He takes his glasses off, he breaks them, throws them down on the floor, walks down to the front, comes back seeing. Well, there's another guy sitting next to him, saw him do that. So he goes, well, I can do that. So he breaks his glasses, walks down to the front, comes back, tapes his glasses back together. Why? He didn't get a ring. You see, God didn't really speak to him about you're healed. He might have read it, but he never got it. We read scripture all the time. Amen? But do we hear from God? Do we act upon it? Does it get into us? This is why we're supposed to meditate, study the word, wait on God. God will speak to us as we do that. And so, you may listen to the word of God, you may study scripture, but only when the Holy Spirit comes and quickens that to you, stirs your heart, the scripture becomes the logos that you're reading, becomes the rhema. That's exciting, when God speaks to you out of that word. Only then will the scripture burn in your soul that you have to do something. And you will know that word applies directly to you because you'll hear. I remember one time I was getting miles up on my car and I said, God, I need a new car and I can't afford a car payment now because I'm not in the plumbing trade anymore. So I don't know what comes in every week because I travel on free will offering basis. So can't you give me a car paid for without payments? And the Lord said, yes. I got a rhema just like that, that just that quick. God says, yes. And I went, well, how come you didn't do it before? He says, you never asked me before. We have not because we ask it, right? I mean, we have to ask in faith, right?
Yeah.
So, to be honest, I didn't think it was probably possible to get a car paid for. Someone give you a car paid for, or somebody give you the money for that? I mean, who does that? Unless they hear from God. And so God told me, yeah, I'll give you a car paid for without payments. I'll tell you what, I got a rhema. You know what I did? I went around telling everybody I was so excited that God was going to give me a car paid for. I went around telling everybody. Told my friend Bob, Bob, God's going to give me a car paid for. He goes, wow, that's fantastic. And I went, yeah. You know, a year later, Bob, I can't wait till God gives me that car. He says, I'm sick and tired of hearing you talking about that car. Will you just go to the car lot and just buy a car and pay payments? I went, God said he was going to give me a car without payments. Well, I'm tired of hearing you speaking this faith stuff. And I went, what are you so upset about? I'm just confessing my faith. People get angry when you confess your faith in God. I'll tell you what. And so I said, I don't know why you're so angry, Bob, unless God's talking to you about giving me a new car. No, he's not. He walked away. What are you so angry about? You should be rejoicing with me, praying with me. Speed it up. It took me 3 years, but I kept confessing that car, and I got one.
Praise God.
Right.
Now he gave me the car paid for. Amen. Hallelujah. He supplied the money in a direction I never thought it was going to come, but it came. I paid cash for that car. Hallelujah. That was 13 years ago. I still got it. Lord, I need a new one. I'm believing God for another car. Amen? Why? Because he's able. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. We just have to spend time in building our relationship with him that we can hear him when he talks. And how we're going to get those things. I mean, it's, I don't know about you, but it's exciting. And only then will you receive faith, for faith comes by rhema, or hearing him speak to you. Amen? Remember Philip in Acts chapter 8, the Spirit of the Lord. Now, Philip was in the middle of revival, and God said to Philip, I want you to get out of the desert and just hang out there. I want you to do something. So he goes down to the desert, he's hanging around, you know, just waiting. Okay, I'm here. He heard the voice of God. He heard the rhema of God. Amen? And then the Ethiopian came by in the chariot, and he saw him, and he walks up to him, and God says, go a little closer, listen to what he's saying. So he get a little closer, and he's about the book of Isaiah. Well, who is this guy? And, oh, well, let me explain to you. So he baptized a guy, he wins him to the Lord, and he goes back to the Ethiopian nation and wins the whole nation for God. Why? Because Philip got a rhema. He heard the voice of God, which compelled him to go down to the desert. Leave a revival to go where there's nothing but sand, but God had a greater plan. Hallelujah. And that's why we need to get ourselves in positions to hear the voice of God, or the rhema. Reading the word, God can speak to you off of that word, but you got to read it. You got to meditate on it. You got to think on it. I mean, I do this all the time. I study the Word of God. I've been studying for months now. I just put in my Bible program, God said. And I got hundreds of scriptures where God said. I'm reading and listening to every conversation God has with man. Because it inspires me. It inspires me. Why? Because I want to hear more. And so that's why I do that. I want to hear the voice of God. I remember the first time I heard the voice of God audibly. I was just in the beginning of this ministry, and I walked in the kitchen, and I said, is this really happening to me? And God said, yes, it is. This is real. Boom, I broke down bawling right there in the kitchen because God spoke to me audibly, told me what I was doing was real, and that's what he called me to do. So, remember, the Holy Spirit, of course, will never contradict God's word. Amen? So the words you hear and all of your desires should be carefully screened against the scriptures. So how will you hear his voice? Certainly this is truly an age of busyness. Many, far too many of these that call themselves followers of Christ are not taking time to even listen to him, which is sad. And we often take time to listen, don't even take time to listen to each other. Have you ever say about how many times people hardly listen to anyone anymore. You know, I saw these three girls walking down the street, all three of them were on their cell phones.
Yeah.
I didn't know if they were talking to each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or talking to someone else. Like, my goodness, everybody's texting. I count them all the time. You know, I'm sitting at the light, and the light's green, and I'm going, they must be texting. And I blast on the horn, I go by them. Hey, I got their phone in here, and they're trying to text, you know.
Right.
I mean, they're so busy, they're not paying attention, and that's what's happening. We're not paying attention. I mean, there's a story that's been passed down for centuries by President Franklin D. Roosevelt. Apparently, the President Roosevelt, he kind of got sick and tired of his, you know, expected smile and his presidential smile, saying that the usual expected things out of the president's mouth when he had all these diplomats coming at the White House. And so one evening, he decides to find out whether anybody was really listening to what he was saying or not. This is President Roosevelt. So one evening, he decided to find out. So as each person came up to him with an extended hand and flashed that big smile at him and said, I murdered my grandmother this morning. And people would automatically just respond comments like, oh, how lovely, Mr. President. It's so nice to meet you, Mr. President. And nobody was really listening to what he was actually saying except this one foreign diplomat. And when the president said, I murdered my grandmother this morning, the diplomat responded softly, I'm sure she had it coming, Mr. President. That's a true story. But, you know, it's funny because people do that all the time. You're talking to them, but you know, you can tell if they're listening or not.
Right.
And, you know, how do you think God feels when he's trying to talk to us and we're pretending to listen, but we're really not? You know? You know, like that scripture, we worship with our lips, but our heart's far from him. But I think we need to slow down. We need to calm ourselves. We need to listen to the Lord and to others around us. You know, listen prayerfully when you read the scripture and when you listen to a sermon. Wait on the Lord for that rhema. I'm giving you the rhema of God this morning. God is speaking to us through this message here this morning. Why do some people not hear the voice of God? Well, gospel reading today is crystal clear. You do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I give my sheep eternal life and they will never perish. I was on the plane coming over here last night, and this woman sitting next to me, she was telling me about all the great religious cathedrals, because she asked me what I was doing. I said, I'm a traveling minister. She goes, oh, I visited these great cathedrals over in England, and I went, Jesus sat on a mountainside and said, when this disciple said, look at how beautiful the temple is. I said, Jesus said, every stone will be thrown down. Heaven and earth will pass away, but God's word won't. You know, she didn't even get a word I said. Why? Because she wasn't born of the Spirit. I gave her spiritual, I spoke a spiritual voice into her spirit, but her spirit was dead to it. And that's what the scripture tells us. So we must accept the gift of eternal life, which is found only in Christ. And confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you will receive salvation. You know, it's interesting, some only hear the logos when you tell them about salvation. In other words, they just hear the written word, but they never hear the rhema, God speak to them. A lot of them don't. I've led people to the Lord but never changed. Because what? They never received it. That's why we don't, that's why people don't follow the Lord, is because they don't get that word from God into their spirit. They don't hear it, or they don't want to hear it. We must give time to our Lord, put our lives in neutral gear, and not forward, not backwards, but completely calm in our hearts so we can hear from the Lord. We need to wait upon the Lord. We need to say silently aloud, Lord, I'm here. I'm listening. I like to quote 1 Samuel 3:10, your servant is listening, little Samuel said. Amen. When Eli, he went to Eli three times when the Lord spoke to him. And he says, when you hear that voice again, you say, yes, Lord, your servant is listening. And I always do that when I'm finished talking my talk. Okay, Lord, I'm listening. Now you just tell me. And I just wait on God, and he'll tell you things. I often begin with the words like, I love you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. You start just praising him. And then they wait peacefully and listen for the words that he can speak to you. I remember when I was praying, and he told me to pray for my brother-in-law who had terminal cancer. He said, I want you to pray for him, lay hands on him, I want you to curse that cancer, and it will die. That's what he told me. So I went to him. They only gave 3 months to live. I went to him. I said, the Lord's going to heal you, Jim. And he goes, well, it's going to be pretty difficult. They gave me 3 months. I said, well, I don't care what they said. This is what God said. Well, that was 24 years ago. He's still alive today. And I want to hear from God. I fasted and prayed. I wrote questions out, pieces of paper. I probably told you this last time I was here, but I'll tell you again, I used to write questions out on a piece of paper that I needed answers for. I'd lay them before the Lord, and I'd pray, and I'd just wait on God until I got those answers. And, you know, it took me 2 or 3 days, but finally he gave them to me. He spoke to me, and he said, read your question. I read the question. As I read the question, he gave me the answer. He gave me the dates. He gave me the times. And it all came to pass within a few months. Why? Because I spent the time wanting to hear a rhema from God. A rhema. See, fasting is a good tool. You deny your body so you can hear more in your spirit. You know, I think fasting seems to bring me closer to the Lord. It heightens my spiritual antennas a little better. But we need to hear from God. You know, there was a story about a man that had difficulty communicating with his wife, and so he concluded that his wife was becoming hard of hearing. So he decided to conduct a little test without her knowing about it. So one evening he sat in the chair far across the living room, and her back was to him, and she couldn't see him, so he just very quietly whispered, "Can you hear me?" There was no response from his wife. So he moved a little closer and he asked again, "Can you hear me now?" Still no reply. Quietly he edged a little closer and whispered the same words, but still no answer. Finally he moved right up behind her in a chair and said, "Can you hear me now?" To his surprise, she responded with irritation in her voice and said, "For the fourth time, yes." See, the hearing problem wasn't with her. It was with him. And the hearing problem is not with God. It's with us. And this is why it's time for those that are mature in Christ to submit our busy lives to the Lord and seek his will. Our Lord loves us so very much, and he's calling to you today to develop that deeper relationship. Do you hear his voice? Because his sheep hear his voice. You know, some people don't hear him. Christians. I remember being in this church in Ohio, and this woman was deaf, and I said, I saw this person doing a sign language to her. And God reminded me when I was putting this thing together, God reminded me of that deaf woman. Remember? She had someone doing signs in front of her so she could hear. And I went, yeah? He says, well, that's how a lot of my Christians are. They're deaf to my voice. So they call out to me for signs. Signs. I heard a lot of Christians say Gideon put out a fleece a weekend. They said Gideon didn't have the Holy Spirit living inside of him. We do. Those that are born of the Spirit are led by the Spirit. Gideon put out a fleece because he didn't have that witness inside him. But a lot of Christians do that. I believe God uses those because they're not listening and they're called signs. I don't want to have signs from the Lord. I want to hear the Lord speak. Because many, as you may know, his will and growth in faith and hearing his voice is from being in his presence, reading his word, and then letting God speak to you out of his word. For it is only in his will that we are free. Amen? So we need to seek God. Let's not be deaf Christians, spiritually deaf. Let's get healed spiritually, so we can hear his voice. Amen?
Amen.
Father, we just thank you this morning for your word to us. And we just pray, Lord, that your word has gone forth as you gave me to give, that your people were listening this morning. I pray that this gets into their spirit, that they heard. The sheep do hear the shepherd's voice, loud and clear if we want to. If we're your children, we're supposed to be tuned in. If we're not, then we're just being led by signs. I know the scripture says in the last day there'll be signs, and that's probably something different, but these are signs too. That Christians are led because they're not listening. Help us not to be deaf Christians anymore, but help us develop an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying. Father, I ask you to speak to everyone this morning about this message, that would draw them closer to you and they would start to listen for your voice, because that's what's going to compel us to build your ministry, your church, our churches, building the kingdom of God by hearing you speak to us. Go unto all the world and preach the gospel. Heal sick. Cast out devils. That's what you said. And we're hearing that. We're going to do what you've called us to do. Lord, I also pray for everybody that's here this morning that need a touch from you. You are the Lord, our healer, our deliverer, our savior. I just pray that you move upon us this morning with your mighty hand once again, that we might see your power as your word declares. These signs will follow them that believe, and so we're believing this morning for great things. And you're here, and we just praise you for it. Let's stand on our feet as we worship the Lord for a few minutes. And I want you to just close yourself in with the Lord and just ask the Lord, or tell the Lord what you have need of this morning. And I'm just going to be listening. I'm just going to be listening for God to say something here. Amen.
And this is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day.
That hand and place it on that part of your body this morning all over this place. God is healing some of the back problems this morning and deteriorating.